I think it was the 16th of March, we locked down the home to all but essential visitors.
Well, we also have to test the residents, so we've got 65 residents and 80 staff that have to be done in a week.
Nobody was allowed to visit, and I think that was a cruncher for my family.
Preparing for a visit which was impossible for months. Putting on full personal protection equipment to enter a care home which achieved a remarkable milestone. It has not registered a single case of COVID-19 amongst its residents or staff.
I think it was the 16th of March, we locked down the home to all but essential visitors, and it was only really the staff themselves and essential people like GPs or nurses who were allowed in and out. We commenced an outbreak cleaning protocol using chlorine-based cleaners, and we started to make sure that high-touch surface areas were, you know, vigorously cleaned. We started looking for extra staff. We didn't know whether there was going to be a lot of staffing pressures, so we took on some extra bank staff. We had to make an outbreak management plan. We weren't really too sure how the virus was going to act if it got into the home. So, and of course, we needed to brief and train all of our staff. They needed to know what was potentially coming. So there was supervisions that took place with staff members during that period.
This care home also didn't accept any residents that were discharged from hospital without testing for COVID-19.
0-0.
Yeah.
0-0.
Which nostril have you got a preference?
When the pandemic initially started, care workers here felt there wasn't much official guidance. However, in late March, a local council quality team was set up and able to provide support, including extra PPE, sanitizer, and infection control grants. Assisting homes to have access to testing their residents and staff was another vital help.
We have to test every member of staff. We've got 80 members of staff, so they have to be tested every week. So we start on a Monday and we run it through to a Friday. We have a courier that comes and picks them up. I've changed my working hours now, so I'm in earlier in the morning, so we can accommodate all this testing, you know, that we have to do. So we're getting there. It's not been too bad, considering it's been the first week. You know, we've done really well. But monthly, we also have to test the residents. So we've got 65 residents and 80 staff that have to be done in a week. So it is a massive workload.
The Widdings home was locked on to all but essential people from mid-March, which helped to keep it COVID-free. Yet it was hard for the families and residents as they couldn't meet their loved ones.
We have obviously dementia patient residents who don't really know, but them that did know and used to go out on visits, they couldn't understand why they couldn't go out or why family couldn't come in and see them. But with the news, watching telly and staff constantly, you know, reassuring them that they are going to see the family and, you know, eventually.
The home encouraged their residents to use video phone calls to keep in contact with their families outside and not feel isolated.
Now, the lockdown came rather suddenly to say nobody was allowed to visit. And I think that was a cruncher for my families. I've two daughters and a son. They've been assured by the senior members of staff that if they ring the Widdings, that's the name of this establishment, they can pass a message, the staff will pass a short message on or hand them their phone, ring the phone to my bedroom and just have a 5-minute conversation saying, are you all right, Dad? Is there anything you want specially, you know? So it worked very well.
Most care home residents have been struggling with isolation. As a solution, some care homes have set up a special visiting area to enable those living at the home to meet safely with their visitors.
That's it. Hello.
To enable family visit despite the risk of transmission, the home has set up this meeting tent in the back garden. Howard and Sue Fletcher are visiting Howard's mother, Kathleen, who turned 100 just a few days ago.
To the first window wave, it was certainly a good 6 or 7 weeks, I think.
Yeah.
And in the life of a nearly 100-year-old who has the beginnings of dementia and forgets, I think that was a concern for us too, that she would forget who we were.
Everybody's been wearing masks and obviously doing the PPE that they've got to use, but this has been really, really good in here, being able to see Mum. And just like I say, the thing is, not being able to hug her or just to give her a kiss, or that's the only thing.
Bye-bye.
Lockdown has been eased, but the management fears the coming of a second wave.
I think in reality, I mean, we're prepared that there might be a second spike in coronavirus cases. Certainly we know what to do. We've got a lot of supplies already. We decided that we'd buy up as much supplies as we possibly could. I think the most difficult thing about a second wave is the staff are very tired. I mean, we're only just coming out of the first wave, in my view. And as lockdown eases, as you know, businesses reopen and people get a little bit closer, distancing is reduced, I think that a second spike is inevitable. But we will be prepared.
The weekly entertainment program is keeping spirits high at a safe social distance. After all the difficulties of the last few months, a welcome moment of joy. Fataneh Farajollahi, BBC News, Bolton.